And again, I'm not going to repeat a bio, but Bianca is probably most notable for finding just about every problem imaginable with our own metadata. She's one of the people who hold her feet to the fire, so I'll let her.
Thank you, Jeff. Now, see if this, perfect. Can you all hear me? Because we tried something different with the mic. Yeah, that sounds like it works. So what I thought of my talk was DORs for whom? Because you all work very hard to provide those DORs, but who's actually using them? Well, I'm one of those people. And I would like to start with the use case that started about a year ago when a colleague of mine from the Netherlands, Egon Willekagen, he published the Winter Solstice Challenge. If any of you know what this image is without looking it up, please tell me afterwards. I was really surprised when I found out what this actually is. But this challenge, what he challenged people, was to find a way to calculate something like an open access score, not only for the papers you yourself publish that are open access, but also for the things that you cite. How much of that is open access? And he challenged people to devise an algorithm for that using open source tools and software. They are. Oh. That's not, you all know what this is. Yeah, no, but good for, because on that one it works.
Help. For some reason, yes. Things are advancing on the laptop, but not on the two projectors.
Okay. That works. That's not. Yeah, beautiful. So, this picture. What's this? Tell me afterwards. It was a picture that Egon used for his winter solstice challenge, where he challenged people to find out. To find out percentage of papers that you yourself publish open access and what you cite that's open access. So he put us online. Well, I love winter, I love being here, I love challenges, and I care a lot about open science. So I thought I'd take this on. And because we've got ORCIDs, and because we had the initiative for open citations, and because we've got Unpayable, I thought this would be pretty doable. I knew I wasn't going to find my Elsevier papers, but okay, never mind that. I thought this was doable. Well, what I found was that from the citations from my own papers, a large majority didn't have DORs. And without DORs, I couldn't use Unpayable to check whether they were open access or not. So I did do it. I did go through the whole thing, but that really drove home to me that it's very nice that we have these open citations now in COSREF, but if they are incomplete, then the way you use them is really limited. And I was actually not the first one to run into this, of course. You all have been talking about this. Also not the first one. Yeah. Because Daniel Acer at eLife, he looked at basically all the citations in COSREF, looked at what percentage was open at some point in April of this year, and how many of those actually had DORs, which were a little bit over half. I did the same thing, taking a random sample of 1,000 articles that had open citations, took random citations from each of those articles, and looked how many of them had a DOI. Now, of course, I only looked at DORs, but that's not the only thing. Citations can have many things wrong with the metadata that are not DORs. For this, I focused only on DORs. Because these were my samples from later, was only articles from 2015 to 2017. I think that's part of the reason why a higher percentage actually had DORs, but still I had about a third that didn't have DORs. And you can find a sample of those on the wall, on the poster, but 48 open citations to journal articles lacking DORs. And what I would really like to know, don't they have DORs? We had someone here who found that it was paper, an article in JSTOR, which has handles, not DORs, okay. Chuck told me that when you look only at the JSON output, you find less DORs than when you look at the XML, so I learned something. But I would really like to ask you, take one of those cards and see if you can find it. And if there is a DOR, why is it not in the citation as supplied, in the reference as supplied to Coursera? Because these references are what you as publishers are supplying to Coursera. And what we, as librarians and researchers who do this kind of stuff, work with. So it got me thinking how that can be improved. And one of the ways it can be improved is, of course, done by Coursera itself. And I talked to Danielle and I talked to Jeff, and you're doing really good work improving citation or reference detection, reference matching, which is great. There are also other initiatives. Wikidata, for instance. Wikidata is gathering a lot of scholarly citations, and there are a lot of them in there that might have different or complementary metadata from the metadata that are in Coursera for those citations, for those references. There's also the Open Citation Corpus, or the Open Citation Initiative, that brings these things together. They do their own matching using EuroPMC for one thing. They are gathering the Wikidata citations. They have the DOR to DOR matching citation index from Coursera. So they're gathering a lot of that. What they do is they sometimes have the same reference, the same citation from Coursera and from Wikidata. They may contain different metadata. They may complement each other, but they are considered separate entities. They're not matched. They're also not fed back into Coursera, which I know for me it's really easy to say, but I would really love that to happen. So, for me, there are a couple of questions that surround it, and I would really like to have that discussion this afternoon or tomorrow. What kind of issues surround that? If you are using other data than the publisher data to enrich and to optimize citation metadata. First question, should that be outsourced? Should that be that responsibility or that role be extended beyond publishers? Or do you think that that's really a job only for the publishers? What sources would you use to get that? What legitimate sources could be sources to get that additional information? How would alternative approaches scale? Because this is really manual. See if you can find additional information. That doesn't scale to 2 million, of course. So is there a way to make that scale? How should provenance of these enrichments be recorded? Does that matter? Probably does. And how do you deal with quality control? But there's some of the things that might be interesting to talk about. Because all these initiatives, there are really interesting things happening. I already mentioned the Open Citations Initiative, that are using a lot of open tools and platforms to bring together a lot of information about citations, about references. Another initiative, the DOR Boost from OpenAir, also starts with Coursera entries and then matches those with additional information from ORCID, from OnPayable, from Microsoft Academic Search for the affiliations, and they build a really rich database. This is getting close to really an open citation index. And a couple of years ago, I was at a meeting where we discussed what an open scholarly workflow would look like and what was needed and what we were still missing. And such an open citation index was really on top of the list. So I find it really encouraging that there are these initiatives that use these open tools and open data to work towards that. And of course also other initiatives. Dimensions came out last year, early this year, I forgot, that as an alternative to Web of Science and Scopus, also a citation database. Lens, relatively new from Australia, also has quite rich citation data and database of scholarly literature and patent searching. Microsoft Academic also is really, really rich. Dimensions and Lens all make use of, again, CrossRef. Dimensions make use of of open citations. Lens does as well. Microsoft Academic does it themselves, but they provide all the information. They make that available. So all these tools are free or partly free. Dimensions has a freemium model, so you can do some things. If you want to do more interesting things, things I like to do, then, yeah, you have to pay. The other ones are free. More interesting to me is that, do they specify what you can do with the data? Because Microsoft Academic, they license their database under the Open Data Commons license, so anyone can use those data, which is why Lens can use them, which is why the UI Boost can use them. Lens is sort of ambiguous. They say that all their data are open for sharing and reuse. I haven't been able to find a CC license on their website, really specifying that. And Dimensions is, they allow you, if you have a license or if you use the free database, to use the data for yourself, but not to share them and make them open for reuse. And to me, that sort of also limits, and especially when you say, okay, we use the open citations, like Dimensions, and we do a lot of work improving them. And then we don't share that back to the community. Of course, I understand it's a business decision, it's a business model, but there are ways, there are other ways to do it. And CrossRef, I think, is a prime example of other ways you can do that. If you look at these three, then Dimensions, we know that's from Digital Science. The Lens, that's supported, founded and supported by an NGO and a university, and getting a lot of funding from non-commercial charitable funders and also commercial initiative. So it's really a mixed bag. Microsoft Academic, they make all their data freely available as part of their Microsoft Azure for Research project. So there are different models to do this. And when you think of, okay, how can we make this really public, open infrastructure, like what CrossRef is doing? What kind of models can we think of that? And I'm going to try something here, because 2 months ago, I gave a talk for the JSTOR, at the JSTOR workshop, the Joint Roadmap of Open Scholarly Infrastructure, that quite angered some people in that crowd. So I'm going to try it again, see if I can do that again. Because how can we create sustainable infrastructure for open scholarly infrastructure to provide public goods? If you hark back to a really old paper by Marcus Olsen, that Cameron Nalon wrote a really interesting article about, he identified three possible models via which that could be done. One would be compulsion, taxation. So get a slice of, for instance, funder income to finance public infrastructure. The other one is to have things as a byproduct. And by that, I don't mean that public infrastructure, so the data are the byproduct, but quite the converse. Providing that public good has as a byproduct that it also gives membership benefits, club benefits. And that might be one way to look at what CrossRef is doing. And the other one is where, because part of this really is a problem, okay, when you have a limited number of parties to decide what happens, that works well. When you have a really big group, that gets harder. So when you do this as an oligopoly, when you have a small number of players really making decisions on that, that might be another way to make this happen. So there are many ways, many different ways to organize these kind of things. Many different tools and platforms that make different decisions about how open they are, how freely they provide stuff, and the way they finance that. And that brings me to the blog post from Alice Meadows this week on the Scholarly Kitchen that I think a lot of you will have seen, Where she really questions, okay, why do we, as publishers, as tool providers, quarrel so much, bicker so much, and not just get together and do stuff because we all want the same thing. And on one hand, it really resonates, and I really also liked the reply that Ginny wrote on the scholarly kitchen, where she totally agreed and she said, yes, if we, because we really could. If we, the more tools and platforms we have, and I'm going to quote this, that go open source, that get long-term backing and broad governance, then the more likely we will actually be to work together. And I would like to maybe question that a little bit, because yes, that would be really good, and it also really closely matches the principles of open scholarly infrastructure from Jeff Bilder and Cameron Nalen and Jen Lin. But it's also a choice. It's also a choice that that's the way you want to work. And that might not necessarily be how different parties feel about this. And that brings me to something that we did last month at Force 11, where we really looked at, okay, if you talk about open platforms, what does open mean? What do you find important in that? Is it that it's open source? Does it need to be non-profit? Do the data need to be openly licensed for reuse? Does it need to be free for the end users? Does it need to be stakeholder governed? And different people and different parties may think differently about this. And that's what I would like to ask you now. So, if you would go, those of you who have a device, and the Wi-Fi is pretty good here, if you go to this link, you should see a form where with five checkboxes with exactly these five criteria. And then I would like to ask you, when you think of open tools and platforms for scholarly communication, what criteria are important for you? You can click off, you can tick all five, or none of them, or just one. What do you think is important? We'll take a couple of minutes to do that. Eighteen people so far. I think there can be more people. Okay, maybe we'll take one or two more minutes. And perhaps when you've done it already, knowing this group better than I do, you can maybe make for yourself a prediction what the aggregated results will look like for this audience. That's this. Quite interesting. Open source, pretty high on the list. What I did, by the way, here is I took a cutoff of 66%. So anything that was voted for by more than 66%, two-thirds of people who voted, they get the green switch. That's, of course, arbitrary. But if you do that, use that cutoff, then it's open source and open license data that gets a plus from you. And you see, when you think of all the different platforms that are out there, and that also Alice mentioned in her blog post, because there's so much out there, can't we just work together and make that more efficient? Well, those criteria that you find important also really have an impact on what tools and platforms you find acceptable. And you can try that yourself. I'll show the link in a minute. Because depending how you set these switches, you get other tools and platforms that comply. So again, this was your result. When I did this last month at Force 11, where there was a little bit of a different audience with more researchers, more toolmakers, more open science advocates, maybe, the choices were different. So, yes, it would be really good if we could get together and maybe find our common ground and see what then happens. But I would also argue for not forgetting these differences and not glossing over them. Because it's the same with the discussion on Plan S that takes up a lot of my time at the moment. Everybody is for open access. But beneath that service, people differ a lot about their opinions on how to achieve that. As I said, you can try that yourself. This whole presentation is openly available, and there's a link to the dashboard where you can toggle those switches yourself. So different criteria matter. And even when we do get together, when we do all get together and decide on one way forward, like with COSREF and with ORCID, that's really good, and we really get stuff done and things really happen. But at the same time, the more we rely on one type of identifier for something, that also means that we are, almost by definition, excluding people. And we can say that for progress, it's really good that we should all use ORCID and we should all use PIT, but I do want to highlight Sarvan Kapasili, or his last name is difficult, but he's really maybe the gadfly in this whole discussion, because he keeps hammering home, like, I don't want to be forced to use an ORCID. I don't want to be forced to have DOIs for my papers. I do want to be able to participate in scholarly communication and in this whole network, but I don't want to be forced to do this with the centralized system. Now, you can say a lot about this, and, well, I had a talk with Jeff last night about this, that even if you think, if you aim for decentralization, you will end up with a centralized solution, otherwise you can't make progress. But I think it's really important that people like Sarvan keep hammering home this point. And perhaps that's also like in my own open science work and advocacy, what I try to tell people, what I also try to tell myself, that maybe the way to work together maybe requires two things. To be open, not only to be open in what we want to achieve, but to be open in our mindset about what is acceptable and what other people are doing, and really see where we can work together. And at the same time, be critical. Be critical about new developments and how that relates to what you stand for. And finally, back to this Winter Solstice channel. It also got me something really nice. It got me a Scolia profile, which is really the Wikidata-based scholarly profile that I now get to play with, and I'm really looking forward to what you can actually do with that. Thank you. Be open, be critical.
So I'll happily start with one. I think one of the challenges that we at CrossRef face when we're talking to our members about making their metadata available and so on and so forth is measuring how it comes back to benefit them in other ways. So absolutely it benefits you to be able to do some kinds of analyses that you can do and so on and so forth, but are there, it seems that there are, that the benefits that accrue back to the publisher for that are harder to measure because they occur further downstream, and it's harder
Jeff, people at the back can't hear you.
And it's harder to trace the direct relationship. How would you go about trying to
measure that benefit to our members of releasing their data? How does it come back to benefit them?
Yeah, that's a good point. My first answer would maybe be, do you need to question whether you actually would need to measure that, or whether it's more like a long-term, perhaps also more philosophical thing, like contributing to openness because you think that's worthwhile. When you think of developments for an open citation index, when that starts taking off, then it might be very nice to be part of that. When Heather and Jason are going to build their research, their new discovery index, when they want to include open citations, then your Elsevier papers, your Elsevier citations from your Elsevier papers won't be in there. So that might be one answer to that. It's an idealistic answer. I grant you that.
Okay. We have a question over here. Mike.
Hi, Dave Schott from Copyright Clearance Center. Anytime someone says reuse, you know, my ears perk up from the kind of copyright light and licensing standpoint. I guess I was just a curious question. When you describe open, what type of licensing are you talking about in terms of reuse? Are you talking about scholarly reuse, or does that end at the commercial reuse line? Just because, you know, like for instance, in the hybrid OA world, only a tiny portion of that is commercially friendly OA, for instance. So I'm just wondering kind of what type of openness are you talking about?
I think it can be all, and I think we have the CC licenses for a reason, and there's a reason why there's not one CC license. There's a reason why authors can choose what suits them best, and it'll be really interesting to see with the whole Plan S discussion where this will go, because that's one of the criticisms of at least part of researchers, that they don't want to be forced into using CC BY licenses, which I can perfectly understand. On the other hand, if you ask me personally, I think that limiting commercial use also really limits also downstream further use. So I would, if possible, I would always choose CC BY. But again, that's my choice, and also respect choice of researchers who might see that differently.
Yeah, it's Liz from F1000 again. Bianca, how do you deal with some of this in terms of making decisions? Because obviously you can't please everyone all of the time. And when do you feel like something is the moral or the right thing to decision to make, and when not? Because if you try to please everyone, we'll never get anywhere. Consensus decision making is quite a difficult thing, even though it is a good thing in principle. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How do you deal with that?
I'm more inclined to be for diversity also in these kind of decisions, and there to let there be multiple paths and then also just see what works and what doesn't. I think that's ultimately might be more productive than at the front end trying to get consensus and work towards something. Of course, the other part of that is that if you do that, if you end up with way too many solutions, then that's an issue in itself. Although that's, to come back to that, we get that a lot. I mean, I also do the one-on-one innovations project where we look at all the different tools and platforms. And then the question is often like, how do researchers know what to choose? Well, they don't seem to have that much problem with 20,000 journals. And when you go on your phone, you have more than 22 apps on your phone, which is the average number of tools that research told us that they use. So I'm more inclined for sort of multiple solutions and see from there what works than to really from the start want to aim at the one and only ring to bind them.
Okay, we have time for another short question, if anybody has one. Otherwise, if I could ask everybody to give a hand both to, I should have said this earlier, Jody had to go to a conference call, but she will be around later if you have questions to her, but if you could give a hand